We are delighted and deeply honored this afternoon to have as our guest the Honorable Yuzo Ota, Consul General from the Consulate in Denver, Colorado. This is a rare privilege, and we are thrilled that he would have take the time to be with us today. He's traveled from Denver this morning in this wintry weather, and we appreciate his being here and his willingness to share his thoughts with us. We've had a delightful visit with him earlier this afternoon and look forward to hearing from him. He has had an illustrious career with a broad range of significant accomplishments, which are too many for me to remember, and so I'd like to read some of these to you. The Consul General graduated from Tokyo University and began his career in the Ministry of Foreign Affairs. After serving in the Oceania Division, European and Oceanian Affairs Bureau, he enrolled at a university in the United States. After the completion of his studies, he returned to service in the Foreign Ministry, joining the Africa Division, Middle Eastern and Africa Affairs Bureau. He later served in the Domestic Public Relations Division of the Information and Culture Bureau. In 1980, he joined the Administration Division, Livestock Industry Bureau of the Ministry of Agriculture, Forestry, and Fisheries. He was appointed Assistant Director of the Policy Planning Division, United Nations Bureau, in the Ministry of Foreign Affairs in 1982. He became First Secretary at the Embassy in Bangladesh in 1984 and Consul at the Consulate General in New York in 1986. He returned to the Ministry of Foreign Affairs in Tokyo and was appointed Senior Assistant in the Inspection Division at the Minister's Secretariat. He was appointed Chamberlain to His Imperial Highness the Crown Prince in 1991. He became Director of the Passport Division of the Ministry of Foreign Affairs, Consular and Migration Affairs Department in 1993, and Counselor at the Embassy in New Zealand in 1995. He was appointed Counselor at the Embassy in Tanzania in 1997. He became Consul at the Consulate General in Los Angeles in 1999 and Director General of the Refugee Assistance Headquarters, Foundation for the Welfare and Education of the Asian People in 2002. And for the past 3 years, he has served as Consul General at the Consulate in Denver. He and his wife are the parents of a son and a daughter. We're very pleased to have the Consul General here today. As you can see, he has a broad range of experience, and we are deeply honored that he would join us today. Please join me in welcoming Consul General Ota.
Good afternoon. Then I will have a lecture about on Japan and Japanese foreign policy about 30 minutes. And after that, I would like to accept some questions and try to answer fully. Then, at first, it is a very pleasure to be here today and to have this opportunity to speak to you about relations between Japan and the United States. Before I begin, I'd like to offer my sincere thanks to Professor Watabe-san for inviting me here and for making this opportunity possible. And Professor Boyk-san, thank you very much. Arigatou gozaimasu. And I am very delighted to be here in this Brigham Young University to speak. This Brigham Young University has a great deal of history and has had a strong interest in foreign language and culture for much of its history. It is an amazing fact that more than 2,300 foreign students from 126 countries are currently attending this Brigham Young University and make up about 6% of its student body. I hear that currently as much as 74 students are from Japan. Some are from Japan, I believe. The friendship between Japan and the United States began over 150 years ago when our countries first established diplomatic relations. Over the past century, our two countries have forged a solid relationship based on shared values and close economic and social ties, which have made us reliable allies and close friends. Then what are these shared values? We share a fundamental belief in freedom, democracy, human dignity, and the market economy. We also enjoy a vigorous cultural exchange. First, I'll discuss our cultural side. Sometimes I'm amazed by the extent to which element of Japanese culture, both old and new, have found a home here in the United States. These popular Japanese traditions include karate, judo, flower arrangement, tea ceremony, and of course, sushi. So some of you are enjoying sushi a lot, I believe. And as for modern culture, anime is also very popular here. This cultural relationship is two-way street. For example, in sports, American baseball fans have come to know some of Japan's leading players like Ichiro Suzuki, who currently plays for the Seattle Mariners. And in Japan, in recent years, American managers such as Bobby Valentine and Terry Hillman had a very major impact on Japanese baseball as well. The strong ties between our two countries are nurtured through many channels, including person-to-person friendships found in the many sister-city relations. I think Salt Lake City has enjoyed a sister-city relationship with Matsumoto City since 1958. So that's a very long history. Another example of the human side of this international relationship is a Japanese exchange and teaching program, often simply known as the JET program. Sponsored by the Japanese government, this program sends young Americans to work in Japanese schools and local offices. Participants of JET teaches and assisting teaching in English to the young primary school student or middle or high school student, and they enjoy a lot of good experiences in my country. And currently, there are over 2,800 American participants in Japan. Then now, I'd like to turn to the topic, to the economy and trade. As the two largest economies in the world, the United States and Japan combined to account for almost 40% of the world gross domestic product. United States accounting for about 28% of the world's GDP, and Japan about 10% of GDP. And outside of NAFTA, Japan is the largest export market for the United States. And the United States is currently a leading foreign investor in Japan. In Japan, many American hedge funds and financial companies find many lucrative and profitable opportunities. Firms such as American International Group Insurance have become so familiar to Japanese consumers that they are beginning to force Japanese insurance companies to change their traditional ways. So in that way, Japanese financial companies, they have to accommodate to the competitive American companies, and they are changing to make themselves more effective and make more friendly to the consumers. Japan is likewise a leading foreign investor in the United States, with Japanese automakers maintaining manufacturing plants in California, Tennessee, Texas, and other states, and employing a large number of American workers. Some of you are using a Toyota or Nissan or Suzuki or Japanese cars, but almost all cars in this United States are manufactured by Americans in American land. And here in Utah, Japan is represented by such firms as the Komatsu Equipment Company, Murata Machinery Company, and the Shoeido Corporation. Those are machinery or some cosmetic companies. On the political level, the United States and Japan have been very successful in managing the political and security alliance. Japan-US security arrangement have made an enormous contribution to the peace and stability of the Asia-Pacific region. Further coordination is being pursued in order to ensure that this alliance remains vibrantly solid and responsive to the changing international environment. And the major factor in the success of this alliance is the fact that Japan has transformed itself from the introverted, shy country to a nation which actively involves itself in international affairs. So these days, many international situations are changing. So my country, Japan, with along with the United States, try to change ourselves and to adapt to the new international situations. And since 1992, Japan has participated in 8 United Nations peacekeeping missions, including those in Cambodia, Mozambique, East Timor, and the Golan Heights. It has also dispatched missions to the international relief organizations, such as those in Rwanda, Afghanistan, and Iraq. In the fight of terrorism after the 9/11 attacks, Japan has developed naval vessels in the Indian Ocean to supply the free fuel to the UN Navy ships. Those United States Navy ships are engaging in the operation toward Afghanistan. And Japan supported the reconstruction of Iraq through the deployment of self-defense forces in Samawa. Samawa is in the southern part of Iraq. And our self-defense forces stationed in Samawa almost 1.5 years. And we are very successful, and there's no, skirmishes between our self-defense forces and local peoples. And I believe the more internationally engaged Japan becomes, the closer and stronger our alliance with the United States becomes. This is good for Japan, and this is good for the United States, and this is good for world peace and stability. Now, let us look at the new Abe administration. After the Koizumi, former Prime Minister Koizumi, Japan's new Prime Minister Shinzo Abe is 52 years old, very young generation. He appealed to the Japanese people to make Japan a country of beautiful spirit filled with vitality, opportunity, and compassion. Mr. Abe has been widely described as nationalistic, but his nationalistic principles are based on his belief that a politician should consider the security of his country seriously and should think deeply about his people's real welfare at all times. Less than 2 weeks after assuming his new post, Prime Minister Abe demonstrated his determined program, determined pragmatism by making official visits to China and South Korea and resuming cordial relations with our two neighbors. On the domestic front, Prime Minister Abe has committed himself to the continuance of the structural reform pursued by former Prime Minister Junichiro Koizumi over the last 5 years. In fact, Mr. Abe wished to accelerate the process in such field, especially such field as education, social security, and financial consolidation. In order to adapt Japanese society to rapidly changing world political, economical, and social situations, we must change, even if it is somewhat painful. That's the belief of a Japanese, majority of Japanese nationals, and of course, belief of Prime Minister Abe. His aim is to keep Japan competitive along other nations. And as for our bilateral relations, under Prime Minister Abe, the Japan-US alliance continued to be the solid basis of Japan's national security and diplomatic strategies. And he determined, with strong leadership, to strengthen this important our bilateral alliance. And now we look at the situation in East Asia, one of the most turbulent and risk-ridden region in the world. Regarding North Korea, Japan has been actively involved together with other participating countries in Six-Nation talks to persuade North Korea to abandon its pursuit of nuclear weaponry. The issue of the state-sponsored kidnapping of Japanese citizens by North Korean agents over the many years has not yet been solved. But the attitude of North Korea regarding these two issues is very simply outrageous. North Korea once promised for former President Carter to stop developing its nuclear capability. And under the framework of KEDO, the Korean Peninsula Energy Development Organization, this is an international organization, and Japan and the United States and South Korea, those three countries are the main contributors and gave us free diesel oil to the North Korea to help better the life of its people. However, in 2006, last year, North Korea declared openly that they now possess the nuclear weapons and has even tested an atomic bomb in last October, despite the fact that almost all North Korean people, they are suffering from poverty and malnutrition. Regarding the kidnapping of Japanese citizens, even after several cases and substantial details become public, North Korea continues to submit a variety of denials and false information about the victims. Japanese citizens have started to feel anger against this total lack of honesty and sincerity. To respond properly to this situation, Japan intends to work closely with the United States to ensure peace and stability in East Asia. Then another nation that warrants close observation is China. Military build-up in China is a cause for serious concern for countries in East and Southeast Asia. Many in the region have begun to have doubts about China's true real intentions. China's economic and manufacturing capabilities are increasing rapidly. However, with this economic development comes excessively energy consumption, abuse of intellectual property rights, environmental pollution, and other adverse effects. The Communist Party tries to even now maintain almost complete control over the people's thought, people's movement, people's religious freedoms. However, in recent years, with the advent of tools like the internet and the migration of agrarian masses towards urban centers, ordinary Chinese people begin to notice their reality and that of the outside world. The average Chinese citizen enjoys very little political or religious freedom. Chinese citizens who oppose the current government are still routinely imprisoned or executed. It is widely reported that even the recent anti-Japanese demonstrations would have been impossible without the tacit approval of the Chinese authorities. But ironically, this implicit inducement to anti-Japanese demonstrations almost opened the door to the political rallies for the democracy and freedom. And it is up to China whether it can be a responsible member of the United Nations Security Council or not. Here also, Japan intends to work closely with the United States to maintain stability in East Asia. In concluding, I would like to stress that the United States and Japan have a very solid security partnership as well as an economic partnership. This is representative of the close bond that we share and our common belief in the principles of democracy, human rights, including freedom of religion and speech. We are proud of this alliance and partnership, both for its mutual benefit and for the good benefits for the world, international society as well. And thank you very much. I just end my part of some speech. So I accept question from you, and I would like to answer. Okay. Yeah, please. Oh.
So, as the end of your speech, you were talking about the situation in China and current Asia situation, and it is pretty evident that it's the views in Tibet, Uyghur, and all the other minority abuses are causing the instability in Asian nations. But yet, they are the permanent member in the UN Security Council, and they're about to hold the Olympics in 2008. Yes. But as seen, that they are totally abusing they are totally disregarding the human rights and all those stuff. Why don't the Japan and the United States together pressure China so either to boycott the Olympics coming up or to impeach them from the permanent member in the UN Security Council?
So when we look at the Soviet Russia was some kind of very close society. And before the collapse of Soviet Russia, we didn't know what's happening in Soviet Russia. But in case of China tried to make some economic development. So they opened the side of economic side, but they will try to keep political side as it was. But we, and I believe in personally, that with the openness of economic side, many, as I told in this speech, many Chinese masses start knowing the reality and start knowing the importance of freedom of speech or freedom of religion or freedom of thought or movement of their movement to their, to one place or another place. And if we boycott the Olympics, then there might be some strong, what shall I say, nationalism or some repercussion to the pressure from outside. So I think it's better for us to wait for the Chinese people itself start knowing the value of democracy and freedom. Is that okay? Yeah.
In the introduction, it was mentioned that you've previously worked in Oceania and also in Africa. How have your experiences in those areas influenced your work now with the United States?
At first, in Tanzania or in Bangladesh, I met various Peace Corps people from the United States. And Japan also dispatched young volunteers in those developing countries. So in some section in agriculture or some craft training places, Japanese youngsters are cooperating with American Peace Corps members. So not only in the bilateral side, but in the third countries, Japanese youngsters and American youngsters are working together. And that's a very good phenomenon. And in my experience in Africa or so developing countries, at first, impersonally, I felt I'm very happy being born in Japan with a large accumulation or a long accumulation of good tradition and good culture. Plus, American youngsters also noticed that they were very happy being Americans, and they are part of a helping side, not the side of help. That's my impression.
My name is Jonathan Stradling. My question for you concerns Japan's relationship with the other nations in East Asia. You had some fairly harsh things to say about North Korea and about China in your speech. Mm-hmm. And recently, as we've been studying that situation here at Brigham Young University, a United States professor named Samuels from MIT came and talked a little bit about Japanese foreign policy and that dynamic. North Korea and South Korea seem to be on the road towards unification at some point in the future. And with that as the end state, it seems to me that they will be more friendly with China than with Japan. My question is, Japan's enjoyed a great relationship with the United States over the past half century. Mm-hmm. What sort of steps does Japan plan to take in order to make its relationship with both of the Koreas and China better in the future?
Mm-hmm. About North Korea, even at the United States got angry about violation of agreement between North Korean government and Mr. Carter and the American government. Just as I mentioned, with the framework, international framework of KEDO, Japan, the United States, and South Korea put a lot of money to that organization and supplied diesel oils for the people of North Korea. But ignoring those agreements, North Korea used their resources to make missiles, make bombs, atomic bombs. So, and North Korean secret police, they kidnapped not only Japanese girls and boys, but also South Korean boys and girls, or Thailand, or Lebanon, or Romania, or those places. So just, you know, we have to look at some reality and the facts. Then after studying the fact and the realities, we should analyze the situations. And about, so in that way, we, United States and Japan, North Korea, South Korea, I'm sorry, we helped once to the North Korea, but they ignored our corporate hands, cooperating hands. And about China, of course, many American companies are investing in China, and Japanese companies investing in China a lot. And China is now some kind of manufacturing centers, one of the manufacturing centers in the world. So we are thinking about the welfare of the Chinese people itself. So we have to continue to keep presence, our economical presence in China. Otherwise, the Chinese people itself, themselves will be suffered if we withdraw the plant or investment from China to the United States or from China to Japan. And, you know, Taiwan, they invest a lot in China because there are some, friendliness between people of continental China and people of Taiwan. So in those ways, there are some, controversial points. But on the other side, there are some cooperative side, economical side or cultural side. So we have to think the all elements, every element as a whole, and try to make a best policies to those countries. Okay?
You talked about the Chinese military buildup. I was just wondering what could be some of the bad intentions that the Chinese have with their military buildup, and the effect it could have on the region.
As you know, after the collapse of Soviet Russia, American military have some good grip about the former weaponry, including atomic bombs in Russian areas. And after the collapse of Soviet Russia, many American journalists say that there is an end of a Cold War. And they talked about the world as if there are no totalitarian or communist countries. But in reality, there are over 100 nuclear missiles which can be reached to the United States from China. That's the reality. Of course, the scientific and military power of the United States is overwhelms against China now. But Chinese people also try to have some, independence in the East Asia itself from the United States. Or they would like to have some, hegemony in the East Asia. So recent phenomena is like this. One Chinese submarine would like to go to Guam in a secret way, but on the way around the Okinawa Island, American and Japanese navies, they detected that intention, and they traced the Chinese submarines to the Guam areas. So in those ways, one independent country tried to have some, avoid some influence from another country. That's the reality of this international society. So we are not condemning China by making some self-defense effort. But if that effort is too much, then that would become some menacing or threatening effect to other surrounding countries. So in that way, I talked about China. Yeah.
You had mentioned about Japan's defense agreements with America, and that there are a number of bases, military bases in Japan. When I was there, I noted that some of the Japanese citizens had felt that things should be run differently on the bases, and some of them were discontent with the presence of the bases there. The future of those American bases in Japan, how do you feel that will turn out being, and do you think that the Japanese citizenry does feel that there might need to be some changes made in how those bases are operated?
Mm. So when we talk about public opinions about bases, especially foreign bases, we have to think that, you know, even in Japan, some people are some kind of very familiar to United States, but small percentage of people, either some kind of pro-China or pro-Russia, in the Cold Days, some considerable number of people are socialists. So, and Japan is a democratic country, so we permit the people to believe in different way. So there is a socialist party, there is a communist party, even communist party are permitted in my country. So some small, for example, 5% of population or even 1% of population start saying that we are against the American bases, then mass media will pick up those voices and make a news. But our ruling Liberal Democratic Party and Kōmeitō Party, those two parties are keeping a majority in my country. That means a majority of the Japanese people are supporting the idea of foreign bases in Japan. Those foreign bases are cooperate with our military, our self-defense forces, and all together with a cooperative way, the American forces and Japanese forces can defend my country. So when we read some news, we have to think about the background of that news. Then we can get the real pictures. Okay.
My name is Masaji Watabe, and I teach advanced reading class in Japanese here at BYU. And we're reading the very book you mentioned by Prime Minister Shinzo Abe, Utsukushi Kuni. Okay, if you guys want to join. But in chapter 2, he talks about nationalism. Mm. But as we read the Japanese portion of it, we notice that he used the word aikokushin. Mm. Okay, and I think there's a difference between nationalism and aikokushin, which is a very significant difference. Mm. And I think I don't know if you have in position to suggest Prime Minister Abe, but he should emphasize the patriotism, not nationalism. Mm. For American people, nationalism have a negative connotation, yeah. But patriotism doesn't. Mm. It's a love of the country, like Japanese say in aikokushin. Mm. And I think Prime Minister Shinzo Abe, he means aikokushin, not nationalism, where you become aggressive and invade other nations and so forth. So in that sense, I hope somebody would suggest that he will start using patriotism when he translates aikokushin.
Yeah, thank you. Yes, when we read some translation of some other languages, ideas, or phenomena, we have to think about two things. One is who translated and what the difference of two languages. And at first, Japanese mass media, there are two types of mass media. One is some kind of liberal left side mass media. The other side is some kind of so-called aikokushin patriotic or nationalistic mass media. So some liberal side mass media are opposing, try to oppose or try to pretend to be opposing present regime, whoever. So try to interpret the idea of a present prime minister in a bad way or in an inferior way. So just he mentioned patriotic. There's no bad things. There are a lot of patriotic Americans in Middle East, in Africa, in the form of a military, or in the form of a peace corps, or in the form of a diplomat or a businessman. And in those ways, Prime Minister Abe wished the Japanese people recovered the sense of being a Japanese, or I am being a Japanese, or patriotic tendencies. So just we look at the political situation in East Asia. In 1960s and 1970s, many young Japanese people, they pretend to be a leftist movement. And they believe pretending to be a leftist is some kind of hero or something. But these days, those political phenomena have changed, and socialist element is decreased a lot in my country. And when we look at South Korea now, there was same type of a situation in South Korea in 1970s and 1980s. And many South Korean youngsters pretend to be a liberal, or pretend to be a leftist. And those generations are now in the 50s and the 60s. And many people start saying that President Roh and his leadership groups, they have some reminiscence of pretending to be a left. So they would like to be familiar with North Korea. And some part of conservative part of North Korea, South Korean people, feel anxiety about the position or policy towards South policy to North. So we imagine that next presidential election in South Korea is a very, what should I say, will change rapidly. And the next South Korean regime or president would be a more conservative than president now.
With the rise of the economic and military power of China and the potential for nuclear weapons in North Korea, there is a debate in Japan regarding the Article 9 of the Constitution and whether or not the Article 9 should be revised or simply eliminated so Japan can become a normal nation.
Would you please just update us on the current debate and the Abe administration's attitudes towards revising Article 9?
Yeah, Prime Minister Abe would like to revise some part of the present Japanese constitution, especially in the part of non-holding of defending power. Article 9 stipulates that Japan cannot have a defensive or warring power. But it is some kind of not practical. If someone attacked Japan, for example, North Korea launched a missile to Japan and some village are destroyed, then we have to wait for that kind of situation. That's a genuine doubt among the Japanese people. So present argument is we should have some defense power, defending power. And other part is anyway, I'm sorry. And in reality, after the Korean War in 1950, we have some kind of powers, and we spend a lot of money, and we are importing a lot of American jet fighters and American equipment. So, plus, you know, this is some kind of supposed way. I suppose that if there are some North Korea invading Japan, then we can push off the North Korean any type of armies easily, because we have a jet fighters and we have a Aegis anti-missile ships and jet fighters and tanks and a lot of those things. So many Japanese people start thinking that we should narrate the present situation more simple way. After the defeat of Japan by the United States occupation powers, they in reality drafted the present Japanese constitution and changed it into Japanese languages. So that's the reality. So many people believe that we should have some defending power. Otherwise, we have to rely upon the United States armies and navy and air forces stationed in Japan 100%. But that's not So at least we should defend our own land or something. So we'll change our constitution to the normal way, just you mentioned. So that is not the intention to be a militaristic power. That's not the intention to be a totalitarian nation. We still continue to be a democratic and land of freedom.
Thank you very much.